So let me maybe, I guess, transition that because it sounds like, you know, you've been on enough job sites that you've got a lot of experience. Because I guess the only way that would be of value to an applicator is if they're doing almost like production work. Well, I do, you know, I work for the same builder and all the homes are basically the same. And, you know, we've got 150 homes we're doing from this year, and that's 80% of what I do, then I guess maybe you could use that as a measurement. But what you're saying is like, you know, hey,
that'd be the only time.
Yeah, if you get into multiple job sites, you never know what you're going to encounter. So let's transition that of maybe a point of value to when we're talking about the bidding and estimating team, you know, the sales team for the contractor out there is like, what do they need to know about different job sites? Because when they're out trying to put together a bid on this, you know, from what you just described of having, you know, one job that you can have, you know, where an applicator can spray multiple sets of foam during a day versus another job site where, you know, it might take them all day to do a half a set or a quarter of a set or whatever it might be. What's kind of a good thing so that they're just not measuring, you know, is there a good way to have an understanding of when they're looking at that takeoff or that blueprint of having understanding of really what is going to be the scope of this job for my production crew that has to install this thing, knowing that, hey, there's a difference between this, you know, this job that's going to require, you know, three or four times the amount of labor that this other one would. Versus the same install set of foam.
Yeah, it's going to be based on past experiences and doing job tracking and learning from the past. You know, when I started quoting our my own jobs, I thought, all right, this is certainly just going to be a one-day job in and out. And all right, it takes you a day and a half. All right, what caused me to delay that job a little bit? Well, the setup of that job. It was tight quarters for half of that job. So I think is, these salesmen are looking at a job. They need to say, well, I can't really fit in that hole very well. How is that applicator going to be moving around trying to get, you know, mass production done if I can't even fit in there to look at the job? I've seen that on multiple jobs.
Yeah. Would you say then it's still almost critically important to track how much time it takes on a job to give that feedback loop to the sales team? Is that where the value then comes on tracking how many hours per job?
Yes, they should be reviewing past jobs and see, you know, was it a matter that somebody sprayed too much chemical in a facility or was it labor hours? If they were right on with the foam consumption, then it had to have been labor hours. Was it because of the layout of that job? Or, you know, maybe a government facility, there's a lot more downtime involved there that you don't take into account when you're bidding that job.
So you're just saying just track everything and then learn from your past jobs then. Is that pretty good?
Yeah, absolutely. Pretty
good. Yeah, I think that's sound advice. That's teacher. I'm sorry, what's that?
The past is a great teacher.
Yeah, that's a great saying. I like that. But yeah, that's a cool thing. I think that's a really neat tip that we can give out to the sales team out there is like, look, you know, we're tracking the production hours to give you guys the feedback loop on how you can get better. And it's less about the production team and more about you. And that's kind of a neat thing to be able to train both parties on that side of it and to tell your applicators, no, you guys need to track your hours, not only so we understand our job costs, but it also provides feedback to our estimators to make sure that they're bidding the jobs appropriately, so that, you know, we can be a profitable company. But yeah, that's kind of neat. Any other comments or thoughts for tips that you might want to give applicators or to the sales guys out there?
Well, for the applicators, it certainly don't be afraid to experiment, you know, and then whenever you're in doubt, having issues, don't be afraid to ask for help. You know, that's one of the things that, unfortunately, most of the applicators out there are men, and our biggest mistake is our pride. We don't want to ask for help when we need it. And I think that just costs too much money because it results in a lot of downtime. And to me, downtime is unacceptable in this industry.
Yeah. You get the calls when it's too late, right? Is that what it is?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. You know, we don't read either. You know, when's the last time you read a roadmap, Alan, or open up an instruction manual for something? And, you know, these guys just, like I said, they plug and play. Well, I've always done it this way. Well, read the manual. Maybe it tells you some tips on how to increase productivity or even make yourself feel a little bit better at the end of the day. But we don't do that as men. And I think that's another thing that really holds people back.
That's probably much more important when you get into working with new chemicals or new equipment that you never used before, is really have an understanding of that. Because I've heard of stories of like, well, yeah, I just recirced what was left in the drum into this new, you know, into this this new drum of material that I just got. And then they go, well, you just ruined that whole drum because you're not supposed to mix the two chemicals together.
Absolutely. That's a man for you. We don't read, we don't ask.
Yeah, and hey, that's what I've done before in the past. Why would it be any different, you know? So, yeah, it's just one of those cautious things that anytime you're dealing with new equipment, new product, just make sure that you got a clear path to success, that you don't get yourself into trouble.